A little bit away from the topic is the dynamic programming. What is the meaning of dynamic programming? Whenever I discuss dynamic programming in the context of the exponential problem, right now we have already know the main problem are basically the polynomial problem. Polynomial problem, always remember the best complexity is O1, that is push pop, the simplest. Then comes log n. Whenever you try to find it from binary search tree, that is a log n complexity. Then comes the n, if you want to find an element from an array, that is n. That way, n log n mass sort, then n square insertion sort, n cube matrix multiplication. Most of the complexities, the polynomial problem is like this. Hardly any goes to the n to the power 4, n to the power 5. But then the exponential problem, I have given an example. It's an exponential problem. So, when 10 goes to the head of the thing, that is the Tower of Hanoi, that is the first exponential problem, then travel assessment problem, that is factorial in order. Then lots of other problems with the exponential problem. But certain exponential problem can be converted to polynomial problem. That will, what is the context of the discussion? Because whenever you have context free grammar, we know the it will be O n cube. It is a polynomial problem. Then if you go for context sensitive grammar, it is an NP complete problem. It is an exponential problem. But with the clever techniques in the grammar, you can make this this thing. You can make this parsing not O n. O n is the ideal. O n we can do it from the LL1 and LR1 grammar. You should always remember most of the programming languages are LR1. Now, what is the advantage of LR1? You know that left recursion may be there, but whenever you have LL1 grammar, there cannot be any left recursion. So LR1 is the best bottom-up parsing, and complexity comes O(n) as the our regular grammar, and that is the best for programming languages. Now comes the how to attack the exponential problem. The exponential problem, you already know this chess. Chess. Whenever you are playing a chess, every we have 8 combinations, and 8 combinations. And whenever you say a winning move to somebody, say Vishwanathan Anand, he cannot quickly check it that whether that winning move is working or not. So whenever you are finding it an exponential problem, whenever you are trying to match the solution, it is also an exponential problem. This is a very hard problem. This is hard. So always remember, chess is exponential, very hard problem, not NP complete problem. Then what is NP complete problem? NP complete problem are those which are very difficult to find it out. But once you give a solution, you quickly check it out. Like our factoring problem. If you have given a big number, say I tell you that tell me the factors, it's a big problem. But if I try with these numbers A and B, whether that okay or not, you within a millisecond you can do it. So NP complete problem, try to find it a very difficult, but whenever you are giving an answer, you can quickly check it out. Like click problem in a graph, that in a friend circle you want to invite some friends, a party that everybody know each other, and you want to know what is the maximum size of that group. That is called maximum click. Then if you have 100 friends, and if you want to invite in a even in Google Meet, those who are friends with each other, it will take 10 computer years to find it. The maximum size of the clique, the size of the clique is around 30. So that is the toughest problem. So, but once you are given the, this is your clique, you can quickly check it. So these are very essential, very, it is also very hard problem, but not hardest. Now, another kinds of problems are coming, that is the cause that can be solved by a exponential problem, that can be solved by the dynamic programming. Dynamic programming name is misnomer. I have told you, please read it, whatever is written there. I have told you, dynamic programming, he is working in a defense lab, Richard Bellman. So he doesn't want, the boss is very against his research and all this. So what he done is a clever technique. Basically, he had programming means planning, not programming. And dynamic, he wants to confuse it so that it's a dynamic planning sort of thing. So you have it's a kind of divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. Divide and conquer, you know the Mars sort is a best example. What is the advantage of Mars sort? Mars sort is, if your memory is 16 GB, and if you want to sort it 1 terabyte data, you cannot put everything into your memory and sort it. That is not possible for insertion sort, and that cannot be possible. So only way is smart sort. You divide the, chop the particular array, put it in secondary memory, bring it to the primary memory, you then merge it like this. But you need extra space is there, but it is the only possible solution by the smart sort whenever your memory size of the number is more than your primary memory. Then the smart sort is the only way. So, same, this is a divide and conquer policy. This is in, smart sort is invented around 1950s. But 1960 onward, 1957, Richard Bellman developed the dynamic programming. Dynamic programming is nothing but again it's a divide and conquer. But here the problems are not so distinct, but the problems can come up from the bottom up. So what you can take a small portion of the area, you take a solution, put the solution elsewhere and try to better it the solution. It is an optimization solution. So this is one. So this is really advantageous, say Fibonacci series calculation. You see this is the Fibonacci series, this is Fibonacci series number 1, 2, and you saw that number is the add of the two numbers that you all know. So what is the great thing about Fibonacci series? If you calculate and store it in a table and stable, then you can quickly get it the solution of the Fibonacci number. So if you do not store a number, that is maybe exponential problem, because you have to calculate again and again and exponential problem. It is, but whenever you have solve it in a save it in a tabular form, that is it is a very polynomial problem. So certain problems looks like exponential problem, like Tower of Fano, looks like, but can be solved it by this dynamic programming or dynamic planning technique by Richard Bellman, so that it can become to polynomial size. So Fibonacci is a great example. Here also Richard Bellman has said that his boss is Wilson, say cleverly give a name of programming, because if your programming is a name, then nobody can do anything and research cannot be there, and say put the name dynamic. Actually it should be dynamic planning. It is like this. Listen, because why you are learning dynamic programming one technique? Because it is the technique will be parsing in the NP complete area. Whenever you might have one or two context sensitive grammar, because they are so tempting, they might be there in programming languages. Then the dynamic programming can solve it in a linear amount of time. Your CYK algorithm, one of your students have mentioned the CYK parsing algorithm, they use the dynamic programming. If you have any question, you can tell me. This is the Richard Bellman, the principle of optimality. For every stage and every decision, that starts an optimal plan from this stage. The optimal plan consists of the given decision followed by a plan which is optimal with respect to the successive stage. So this is it. So you have to, it's a bottom-up, like your, even similarly like bottom-up parsing. Here everything comes from bottom-up. Here the great thing is, this is a traveling salesman problem, Hamiltonian circuit problem. So I have to traverse every node and I should have minimum distance. So it is a factorial n. Factorial n is much greater than 2 to the power n. These are all called an exponential problem or intractable problem, but they are not as hard as a Turing-Halting problem. So Turing-Halting problem is another landmark, which is the toughest of toughest problems. So there is no solution till now. This is a Turing-Halting problem. And it is proven there cannot be found any solution from Turing-Halting problem. Okay, that will come. So these are the problems you should remember as a landmark of your algorithm skill, algorithm complexity skill. So these are the problems. Like entry-complete problem, more tougher than entry-complete problem are exponential problems, like chase. These are the exponential problems. Okay. So this is dynamic programming. This factorial problem can more like this form. So this is that it cannot come to the linear, but it much simpler. Dynamic programming is a problem-solving technique that solves a problem by dividing into subproblems. It is used when these subproblems are dependent. That is when they share the same subproblems. It is normally used for optimizing a specific problem and follows the principle of optimality. Is there? Here you can see, I think you have all done it simple. You want to, from this node, from S node to T node, you want to traverse what is the minimum path. How can it be done by dynamic programming? From 0, the distance is, this is a directive, from 0 to 5. So I calculate the same stage, it is a 5, and it is a 3. Now C, how it is distance of C? It is a 5 and 3, 8. So I write it 5 and 3, 8. But I can write 3 and 6, 9. Because 8 is less than 9, so I put 8. Same, how to reach S, 8 plus 1, that is 9. And if you go for other way, like D, here is B3, and here is 3 and 5, it should be 8. But I can go from minimum way, the 5 and 2. So I put 7 here. And I, how can I reach this? 7 plus 4, 11. But I have already got 9 from this path. So this is the minimum path from AC. This is the one clever technique by dynamic programming. So whenever you are calculating, in a table, and whenever new thing is coming, you compare. This is a very good technique of dynamic programming, shortest path in directed graph. I think you have understood it. I think I should not repeat. So dynamic programming, well-known algorithm design technique, divide and conquer, another strategy for designing algorithm that is your know. Dynamic programming is typically applied to optimization problems. I have told you, this is, computer science basically consists of two problems, decision problems and optimization problems. And again, I have told you, optimization problems can be converted to decision problems. Say, yes, all computer science problems are basically, are 99.9% of decision problems, whether it is true or false. Even in any optimization solution can be converted to decision solution. So dynamic programming is suited for basically optimizing solution. Dynamic programming archetype used to solve problems. I think these are repeated. I think we can go right now. This is, say here, the Fibonacci series calculation. This is the program in, say, Python. So until when n is equal to 2, n less than 2, n, or otherwise you are calculating. So you are storing it Fibonacci n minus 1 and Fibonacci n minus 2. You are always storing it Fibonacci 1, 2. You must store the result in a table. That is the main concept of dynamic programming. It is another form of divide and conquer technique. So I think you have understood that why you are needing that dynamic programming for our parsing NP context sensitive grammar. That is the why you are needing dynamic programming. The dynamic programming is needed whenever the complexity comes O(n) cube or NP complete in context sensitive grammar. So we need dynamic programming as CYK algorithm, famous parsing algorithm, but that is not in your syllabus. But you should be aware that dynamic programming technique is always used in this parsing technique. Turing machine basically consists of basic Turing machine, then comes the universal Turing machine. What is basic Turing machine? Is a single tape where read head and write head are combined together, or it can be one head which can read and write, and it can go right one more step, left only one, but it must move, it cannot be stationary. And what is the definition? It should start from the left and it read right, and it can left right, and then if it is going on left right read right for huge amount of time, so it doesn't halt, then we call that Turing machine is not halting. That means Turing machine is not going to accepting or rejecting states. So when the Turing machine stops, then we have to check the what is the its pulse or the status flag, whether it is a green, that is accepted, and whether it is a red, not accepted. So that is good, but you can find some of the problems, like in Turing halting problem, I have discussed many others problem, then the Turing machine always move, and it doesn't stop, it doesn't halt, and then we call the Turing machine is not halting, then probably we have bug in that programming that machine, or the problem is unsolved. So it can be, even the problem is solvable, if the programming of the Turing machine is faulty, that your algorithm states are faulty, then the Turing machine can loop around, and that it doesn't halt. Then either it can be that your algorithm or program is faulty, or problem is unsolvable. That is a very hard statement. That is a very definitive statement, because in 1936, great mathematician come computer science. At that time, computer science is not there as a discipline. He is basically a mathematician, Alan Turing. There are five other techniques, like his thesis supervisor, Alan Zuchart, and Prost. There are so many brilliant computer scientists. At that time comes with the unsolvability problem, that is Hilbert tensor problem. So that if we have a polynomial equation, whether there is integer root or not, it is a unsolvable problem. So he proved it by this machine that it is not solvable. So that means every problem cannot be solvable. That is as Turing, but he solved it that way. So that is the basic Turing machine. Now what we add, that is the universal Turing machine. Universal Turing machine, nothing but if you have any problem, you write the steps and coded form and put it in front. When the machine reads by left, right, left, it comes to right, reads that program, the machine functional unit, that is a finite state machine, is become configured to handle the data portion. So first is the program, how to configure the basic Turing machine, then the data comes, machine reads the data, it can output the on it, on the tape itself, or it can make output farther away from it. So both are possible. So these are the universal Turing machine. Now it has been found, this universal Turing machine is one of the ruggedest, robust machine. It is not one of the fastest, first of all. It is one of the robust. What is the mean by robust? Robust means you can give any problem, any algorithm, this basic machine can solve. If this basic machine cannot solve the problem, the problem is unsolvable. So that is a great test of Turing. This is a test, that is a universal Turing machine. Now comes the variants of Turing machine. Now we say the variants, if we can have multi-head Turing machine, multi-tape Turing machine, all this, but it has been proven. It has been proven that even the multi-head, multi-tape and Turing machine cannot only be read-write, it can be northeast, multi-directional, doesn't add the robustness of the universal Turing machine. So these are all variants who may solve the problems a little bit quicker, but it doesn't solve any extra language. So that how to do that is, a machine is more powerful, that powerful doesn't mean it can solve the problems quickly. No, the powerful means it can understand an extra language. Like our non-deterministic PDA can detect the palindrome, but our deterministic PDA cannot detect palindrome. The deterministic PDA doesn't know when go to from push state to pop, but non-deterministic PDA can, lots of non-deterministic PDA quickly guess that this find the point I can stop pushing, get popping. One of the machine is successful. So that then we tell this non-deterministic PDA is more intelligent or more powerful, but it is not realizable. Non-deterministic PDA is realizable in hardware, so it is a kind of a theoretical concept. But in Turing machine, if we apply the same idea, non-determinism, it has been proven that it has the same power. So, for all practical purpose, your basic Turing machine, what it can solve, your universal Turing machine, it just takes the configuration of the basic machine to be configured. That is, that portion is, that is called code. Generally, we call it the code version. Whenever you write a program, it has been converted to compiled, and then it ultimately a 0-1 string. A dot out is basically a 0-1 string. That is the portion you are coding your CPU, giving your CPU to configure the CPU, and your data portion comes next. Then CPU acts on data and write it on your tape or memory. The concept is same like Mealy machine here. It's interesting is Turing machine, one concept is very good as a Mealy machine. Mealy machine also, whenever it reads, it output. It is output. So, and Mealy machine doesn't have any accept rejects, it is always an output. So, that is a Turing machine. So,
sir, yes? You told about dynamic programming. Sir, in yes. dynamic programming, we have some overlapping sub-problems. So we have to
yes.
Optimize those overlapping sub-problems. So,
yes.
sir,
yes.
what kind of overlapping sub-problems occur in automata, which can be solved
that
in
is dynamic? I told you, automata. Yes, very good question. Probably this is my mistake. Automata is a machine. Now, a machine can be used to generate or to accept. Okay, that's true. And now we know our language is type 0, type 1, type 2, type 3. For type 3, dynamic programming is not needed. Type 3 is regular language. It can be solved by ON. Because whenever you are producing a language by generator and you have to accept it by acceptor, a machine. So now comes the type 3, then comes the type 2, that is the context free grammar. Then context free grammar has two parts, deterministic context free grammar and non deterministic context free. Let's consider deterministic context-free grammar. There we can solve it by LR1 technique, bottom-up parsing technique. It can take the all programming language. This programming language has unambiguous grammar. This deterministic context-free doesn't have any ambiguity. If you can properly select and by LR1 parsing techniques, you can not all, but very good portion, you can parsing by ON. Great, like regular language. In fact, whenever your parsing is ON cube, then whenever you are compiling your programming language in any language, in Python and Java, you will be bored. Because whenever the program is bigger and you have to wait huge amount of time, because it is N cube, theoretical limit is N cube. But that we have made it, then till now we do not need any dynamic programming. But whenever it goes for not LR1, say the non-deterministic context-free grammar or context-sensitive grammar. Non-deterministic context-free grammar, it can go to ON cube. That is, then we can use this dynamic programming so that we take the sub-problem and bottom-up and together. And the NP-complete problem is context-sensitive grammar. Context-sensitive grammar, interesting grammar is A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N, or A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N, D to the power N. And another great example of context-sensitive grammar is WW. So all these grammar you need to parse, because this grammar can be in a programming language one or two sentences. Then these problems are NP-complete problems. The NP-complete problems is very hard to difficult. So then you have to mellowed it down. You have to solve it by this kind of technique. These are the programming techniques: divide and conquer. R-sort is one, and the dynamic programming is one. Like they calculated the Fibonacci number, right? The same use, like the factorial number. They try it from the beginning and save it in a table. Then they quickly look up table. The concept is nothing but the sub-problem solution will be required for the greater solution, and it has to be solved in a table. And that table should be looked up. That is the basic. It's a table-driven approach, this dynamic programming. Now, coming back to your question, what is the role of dynamic programming in automata? It is for parsing the non-deterministic context-free grammar ON cube, where the limit is ON cube, then it cannot be LL1 technique, and the context-sensitive grammar WW, and the A to the power N, B to the power N, C to the power N.
Yes, sir.